Since 1887, the Stonington Free Library has been a center for knowledge, ideas, creativity, and entertainment. It is a comfortable and welcoming community space for the town of Stonington, Connecticut, where all ages can explore, discover, gather, and learn within a building of distinctive and unique architecture. This video program is an evolution to expand the offerings of the library to share directly in your home or organization. Welcome to the Thoughtful Thursdays speaker series, made available to you by the Stonington Free Library.
Good afternoon. Thank you all for coming this evening to Stonington Free Library's Thoughtful Thursday lecture. My name is Dodie Bump, and I'm a member of the program committee for the library. And I am very pleased to introduce this evening's speaker, Norb Vonnegut, who will speak about Bitcoin and the wave of cryptocurrencies. Norb is going to focus on sort of the evolution of this social movement. There are over 1,600 cryptocurrencies now, which is mind-boggling. But Bitcoin is the biggest by a factor of two, and it's the one that you hear about most often. I actually own 5 Hush coins, so that tells you what the heck is a hush. But anyway, people speak from personal experience that cryptocurrencies are not quite ready for prime time, but I think he has a theory about the fact that they're going to go mainstream at some point. Norb is uniquely qualified to speak on this topic. Before becoming a publisher of both fiction and nonfiction, including Wall Street thrillers, several of them, they're wonderful, and a column in the Wall Street Journal. He spent most of his career in private wealth management with several brokerage firms, primarily Morgan Stanley, and with a registered investment advisor in New York City. He's a graduate of Phillips Exeter and Harvard College, and earned an MBA from Harvard Business School. Norb and his family split their time between New York City and Narragansett, so he's somewhat of a local boy. He's an avid cyclist and absolutely loves audiobooks. Got that off of his website. At the end of the presentation, we'll have time for questions, and so please join me in welcoming Norb Vonnegut.
Wow, thanks, Dodie. You know, it's great to be here. I'm so happy. You know, the libraries do so much for the communities, and whenever I get an invitation to speak to one, I'm really, really happy about it. And I see that the library here is closing down on Fridays, so the early on Fridays. I may not get that right, but the community has to band together and help out because they're so important to who we are as a nation. So. Thank you for having me tonight, and I hope you enjoy what I have to say about cryptocurrencies. But I have to start with this. In addition to being an author, I'm also the founder of Second Opinion Wealth Management, where I help investors cut the cost of financial advice so they can keep more money for themselves. And I know that's a shameless commercial, but it's also the reason I offer this disclaimer. Nothing that I say tonight is a recommendation to buy or sell any cryptocurrency or any of the companies I mentioned. Okay, so with that, let's turn to these cryptocurrencies. As Jody said, there are 1,600 of those currencies. I am not in order organized here, and I want to make sure that I don't get out of whack. Yeah, so there are 1,600 cryptocurrencies, and the three biggest ones comprise 2/3 of the market cap. So if you take all the coins and all these tokens and whatever they call them and multiply them by their U.S. dollar equivalent, they equal about $250 billion plus. It depends on the time of day it is, actually. Oops. There we go. So it's about $250 billion plus. And the place to go is to this website, coinmarketcap.com. And so this weekend when I was looking at the cryptocurrencies, they had this valuation of $250 billion plus. And today, If you go there right now on your cell phone, you'll see there are about 286 billion. But 250, it's my story on the second left, but we'll just go with that. You know, the thing about this is when you hear a number like 250 billion, it's not real. What does it mean? I mean, it's an unconscionable amount of money. So 250 billion will buy you 2.9 million Teslas. But, you know, where would you park 2.9 million Teslas, right? So you're better off buying the company, which will set you back about 55 billion. And you have more than enough money, you can buy Walt Disney while you're at it. That's another 155 billion. And so you're down to your last 30 billion, and with 30 billion, you can give 100,000 teachers a pay raise of, on average, of 27%, increase their salaries to $75,000 a year, and prepay it for the next 4 years. So 250 billion is a massive number. But as big as it is, it fails to capture the magnitude of what's happening with cryptocurrencies. I believe cryptocurrencies are most significant in that they are a fight or part of a bigger fight to reshape the internet. And the questions that we all have to answer are these. Do we want an internet where nobody's in charge? Or do we want a winner-take-all internet where a handful of victors know everything we do online and make decisions about how this information is used, who it is sold to, where it goes? That's the question that's playing right out in real time in all these 1,600 cryptocurrencies. And I know this sounds a little bit like Big Brother's 2018. But to tell you how I reached this conclusion that cryptocurrencies are part of the fight to shape the internet, I want to tell you a little bit about my personal journey into the world of Bitcoin, which is one of the 1,600 and the largest of the 1,600 with a market cap of over $1 billion, depending on the time of day, right? Okay, so several years ago, I got a call from my agent. And he said, "Norb, what do you know about Bitcoin?" I said, "Not much. I know it's a currency. I know it's electronic. I know that it's also a transfer mechanism. So I can send Bitcoin to India in 10 minutes. And that's about what I know." And I have to tell you, that was really interesting to me, because at the time, our daughter was an intern in India. And if you use the SWIFT money transfer system to wire fiat money, so US dollars to India, and then have it converted into the local currency, it takes about 4 days. So this Bitcoin, it solves the problem. And I thought, wow, that's pretty cool. He said, "Well, how would you feel about co-writing a non-fiction book with a Bitcoin evangelist?" I said, "Brother, I'm all in. Let's tell me. Give me the pen." And he said, "Well, not so fast. Let's go meet him." And we did. So my agent and I met in Manhattan. When we got in the car, we drove down to Brooklyn, and we met my would-be co-author. He was living with his parents. He was recently out of college, and he had created this business as a senior in the middle of the night. Now, think about this guy. Back up for a minute. You know how moms always say nothing good happens after midnight? He said to me, "Everything in my life happens after midnight. That's when my day gets started." And so in the middle of the night, when he was a senior in college, he met this guy online from the UK. And they were lamenting how hard it was, or how long it took to exchange fiat money, like US dollars, into Bitcoin. So those 10 minutes that it takes you to get Bitcoin to India, hey, you lose all the time that you gain just trying to convert U.S. dollars into Bitcoin, at that time in any event. Well, together, this team, this unlikely pair, played a pivotal role, and at one time, according to their estimates, they touched over 50% of all the money that was entering into the world of Bitcoin. All right, 50%, these two guys, they came up with this crazy idea, and they made it happen. And this fellow that I met, he went on a tour speaking about Bitcoin around the world, and he's part of the group that founded the Bitcoin Foundation. And he became my tour guide into this world. He's the one who took me in and explained how it worked and what it does and what you can do with it, when I had started with such a modest base of knowledge. So there I am. I'm in the middle of this Bitcoin world. I'm interviewing all these people. I'm talking to them. And they're a confounding society. Just confounding. Because they're from all over the world. They're from all walks of life. They worship in all kinds of different, are all part of different religions, right? There is nothing that's really similar about this society. But you know what? They were really tight-knit. And it was the oddest thing. So let me give you a few examples of why they were tight-knit. First of all, I'll give you what I call the married couple example. My wife and I, by the way, have been married since 1985, and we'd probably be examples of this. But you know how married couples tell the same stories, and they meet somebody new, and they tell the new person the same stories? I was a new person, and wherever I went, I heard the same stories, no matter where I was, from these Bitcoiners. And they were... They all knew these stories, and a good example of one of the favorites way back when, was a story about 10,000 Bitcoin being used to purchase two pizzas. I think it might have been the first purchase ever, but 10,000 of these things. And so just thinking about that gives me indigestion today, because those 10,000 Bitcoin are worth over $60 million, but you know, who's counting? They had their icons. So we probably have heard about, you've probably heard about Satoshi Nakamoto, who is credited with creating Bitcoin. But show of hands, who here has heard of Bitcoin Jesus other than me and Solomon Daniel? All right. So Bitcoin Jesus was this tech entrepreneur. And he loved Bitcoin. He embraced it early in the currency's lifetime. And he bought so much of it that he ran around the world and he was giving it away free. And he came to be known as Bitcoin Jesus. His real name's Roger, but Bitcoin Jesus. The Bitcoiners I found were a very charitable lot. And the best example I can give to you is this. Now, take a look at this. Hi, Mom, send Bitcoin. All right, so we're in a nationally televised football game here. And the kid who's holding up this sign knows that the camera's going to pan in on him. So the camera pans in on him, and it finds his QR code, right? And you can hold, even when a QR code is on a television, you can hold your phone up to it, and you can read all the information to send Bitcoin to somebody's wallet. This guy got $24,000 US from people he didn't know just by holding this up, which is why this is my QR code. So, more seriously, the Bitcoiners were people really put a lot of deep thought into society. So another question, who in the room has transferred money? I'm not dissing this organization. Who's transferred money with Western Union or one of their competitors? All right, me too. So if you transfer $50, cost you 10, wherever you send it. And there are two kinds of people in the world. You're either a Marine or you're not a Marine. And a Marine who is not presently in the Marines, but was part of this Bitcoin community, said to me, he said, you know, Bitcoin is just great because if you think about transferring money, the poorest get screwed the hardest. Those were his words. You know, instead of paying $10 to transfer 40, you can transfer Bitcoin, and you're there. At the time, there was no explicit charge for that transfer of money. We'll get to how people got paid in a moment, but my only point here is that this community came together and they started to develop an identity, and they attracted people who thought hard about the issues facing society. I mentioned already that they created a foundation. They held conferences around the world. In fact, I spoke at one in South Korea. We had all people. It was the craziest thing. And here's when you know that somebody really, or that a society is really coming together. You know it when they have their own parody band. And I'll see if I might need help on this. Michaela, I'm having a problem. Oh, here we go. Wait a minute. Let's see. Here we go. Oh, I got it. I think. There.
Mr. Bitcoin, bring me money. Give me a chance about this economy. Give me a sign, cause I just lost all my clovers. The US dollar's dropping fast, it's almost over. Mr. Bitcoin, we're all alone. China owns our asses, they own all our homes. So please rise fast on Bitcoin,
so they have their own parody band, and I pulled off YouTube one of the easier ones to listen to. I mean, some of them are really out there. Zhao Tong is their slang, right? Zhao Tong is actually the name of a young man who I think he lived in Singapore. I might be wrong about that, but he was 17 when he created this company called Bitcoinica, and it was a trading platform for what appeared to have been Bitcoin futures or something like that. This was really early on. Poor kid, suffered three spectacular collapses, hacks of Bitcoin, although there's some suspicion that maybe there was something more nefarious going on. But investors lost a lot of money during these hacks. And Zhao Tong now is the euphemistic, polite translation of that slang is somebody suffered a margin call. But if you got Zhao Tong, there are others. You know, think about it. So I guess my question here, seeing all these people coming together from all walks of life, from all around the world, what's going on here? It's got to be something that's important to them beyond going to conferences in the UK to talk about transferring money more quickly. There's got to be something deeper. And I wasn't sure what it was, but from the beginning, I suspected it had something to do with this thing that you read about in the paper called blockchain. You know, what is this blockchain? So let's step back for a minute and talk a little bit about blockchain. And I'll start by saying it is an online ledger that many, but not all of the cryptocurrencies rely on blockchain. And here's an example of why a ledger is important in financial circles. Okay, so Sally, I'll pick on you. I owe you $10, and we happen to bank at the same bank. So I will write you a check, give you the check, you deposit it into your bank. And your account is heavier $10, my account is lighter $10, and the common denominator there is that we both trust the bank to get the details right. Well, there's nobody in control of the blockchain online ledger. Rather, what there are a swarm of Bitcoin users. Some people call them miners. I'd rather call them auditors, and they solve really complicated equations to keep the ledger current online. The information is all online. So I send you $10, you deposit $10, the information's all online. It's out there in the public domain. At a bank, you know, the bank is part of the bank's books, and nobody knows about it. The lack of a central authority is why people sometimes call blockchain a distributed ledger, right? There's no one entity that's governing its operation. Well, why is that important? Let's return to a couple of the Bitcoin stories that were rifling through the crowd when I first got involved. And we'll go back to 2013, and I'll just give you a heads up. These stories feel like a little bit like I'm going off tangent, like I'm meandering around. I probably am, but they're really important for me to, I'm using them to illustrate why blockchain is important. So in 2013, Cyprus had this big crisis, and it was terrible. And they had to negotiate a bailout with the IMF. And after the bailout, the single largest bank in Cyprus, it basically told its depositors that they had 47.5% less money than they did before. So think about it. You go to your bank, and you have $100 on Thursday today, and then tomorrow morning you have 47.5% less. That's a real problem. And this is what the folks, the Cypriots, I guess, had to endure out there. This story worked its way through the community. When I spoke to people in the Bitcoin community, they were always saying, remember Cyprus. Okay, so let's go forward. Let's fast forward to the second story. We're now in 2014, one of the stories that rifled through the community was about porn stars. And the porn stars had all their accounts being shut down by a bank. And no matter what you think about the profession, it is a legal profession. And the bank came in and shut down these accounts for whatever reason. Perhaps they felt that they were complying with the law. Perhaps they were worried about money laundering or whatever. But this had nothing to do with Bitcoin. The question is, why is this story important to the Bitcoin community, and what does it have to do with the story about Cyprus? The common denominator is trust. All right? In each case, people are asking, can we trust our governments? Can we trust institutions that make decisions about our money? It's trust. And blockchain was a way to remove this trust was a way to eliminate the need to trust a third party and to move that trust function, the online ledger, to the swarm of users who kept each other honest, Nobody had control. They were fighting to solve these problems first, and whoever solved the problem first and updated the online ledger was paid in Bitcoin. The currency increased. There's nobody making there's nobody who's making decisions about the money supply or anything. It was just written into the algorithm. So I got it, or so I thought. I mean, my initial reaction or conclusion was, oh, blockchain. It enables a bunch of techie libertarians to opt out of the financial controls that govern money. Okay, think about currencies. Governments can print. Nope, my pages are sticking together. They can print money. They can devalue money. They can regulate how much you take out of the country. But with the cryptocurrencies that use decentralized ledgers like blockchain, the power is in that algorithm that was coded into the currency at its inception. So when I opened a Bitcoin wallet the first time, I didn't have to give out my social security number. I didn't have to make a copy of my driver's license. I didn't have to provide any of the other requirements that I equate with opening up a bank account. There was no third party that was making the rules for me. And so I thought that was kind of cool. And the price of Bitcoin started to roar. It started to really take off in the years that followed. And I was very happy about that. I was telling Dodie, my wife and I are going on a Bitcoin funded vacation to Helsinki later this year. So we got lucky, but it was really luck more than anything else. And but you know, with the meteoric increase in the currency, I kind of like the idea of decentralization, the lack of any one authority. I like this division of power. It kind of reminds me of the Constitution. It feels right. And the fact is, though, I don't really self-identify as a libertarian. So there's got to be, I'm thinking there had to be something that was more important than this idea of nobody in control that was driving the price of Bitcoin and also the interest in blockchain. And I got the first hint when the VCs started talking about the other applications for this blockchain ledger. They started talking about the ability to use it as a way to finalize contracts. Okay, so there's something else there. What I realized is that Bitcoin is getting all the headlines, but blockchain is the real story here. Blockchain's the story. It's why it's important. You know, everybody's really interested in how the Bitcoin value is flowing. It's this blockchain, this online ledger that's important. So let's talk about why that is. And the reason it's important, it starts with the issue of identity. I would say that identity is one of those topics that is sure to stir the emotions in all of us. How information is used about us. If you need an example of identity issues stirring emotions, just look at Cambridge Analytica and the brouhaha that its use of Facebook collected data caused earlier this year. Okay, another way to stir interest in identities, who's had their identity stolen before in the room? You know what? I wouldn't be surprised if every hand in the room should go up, and you just don't know it yet, or the bad guys haven't gotten around to working your files yet. You know, it's a terrible feeling when it happens. So identity is a really important issue, and it's woven into this blockchain. And it started It started with this guy, I think, by the name of Eric Hughes. He started writing about the use of technology in the 1990s as a way to preserve identities and control our identities online. And I'm going to read you a couple of lines from what he wrote. He wrote this manifesto, and it kind of this manifesto spawned this movement. They're known as cypherpunks. I mean, that's kind of a cool name, you know, these cypherpunks. And even though it sounds like it's really off target, listen to these words, and bear with me. First line that got my attention: privacy is necessary for an open society in the electronic age. We cannot expect governments, corporations, or other large faceless organizations to grant us privacy out of their beneficence. He goes on to write, we are defending our privacy with cryptography, with anonymous mail forwarding systems, with digital signatures, and with electronic money. Okay, these loans were written in the 1990s. That was a long time ago. Bitcoin wasn't around. But I think he understood something about the internet that very few people understood at the time. So when you think about the internet, it's built on these protocols. And these protocols are great because they share information, and these protocols are what make the internet wonderful. The sharing of information allows you to go onto a website and to select a product that you want to buy, or to read a newspaper, or whatever. It's really great stuff, the coding that went into the protocols. But, you know, shame on Al Gore if he really did invent the internet, because there is no standard that defines how we secure our identities, or things like our location, other bits of information. And so what that means is that many companies have come up and they've built their businesses on top of these information sharing standards, these protocols, and they'll capture your name and your address and your email and your account number and your birthday and what you bought and when you bought it and other bits of information like how much time you spent online. And this information all is property of the vendors. It disappears in with these companies. It's not on the internet, it's not like the blockchain, it's privately held. Nobody sees it other than the companies. It's their property. So, and again, go back and take a look at Cambridge Analytica, this company that was using the information captured by Facebook. So, who gets this information? Who's keeping? Who has all this data? Well, last month, The Economist published an article about the consolidation of information in today's economy, and the numbers were staggering, just staggering. So listen to this. Google has 91% of global search, so where we browse. Apple has 45% of smartphone web traffic. Wow. Facebook has 66% of social media, who we are, who our friends are, what we like, what we don't like. Amazon, to me, this is staggering. Amazon has 37% of online retail, what we buy. And the venture capitalists have described the companies that are trying to compete with Google, Apple, Amazon, what have you. We can't back companies that try to compete with them because they've entered kill zones. They're not going to last. They're either going to get pushed out of business no matter how good their ideas are, or alternatively, they're going to be purchased. And so the point that I'm making here is that there is a tremendous amount of information that's consolidating on the internet. And that growing concentration of data is the real reason that we should be discussing cryptocurrencies. Not how much they're worth, not how much money people have made or lost. It's a concentration of data. Because the blockchain that powers cryptocurrencies, this online ledger that everybody has, it decentralizes data, that prevents companies from controlling the data about us because it's already out in the public. So how important is this? To explain blockchain, I called it a ledger initially, and I sort of hinted that the definition is expanding. It's more than a ledger, it's really a database. And coders right now are in a mad dash to increase the applications, to code new applications for blockchain. And to give you an example, they're coding to try and use it to record real estate titles, other contracts. And I was telling and Damon, I just heard about this website called Stena.com, which relies on this distributed technology to run its social media platform. And so if you go to Stena.com, it's social media. And the more you comment, and the more your comments are valued, the more that you're entitled to these Steam tokens, which can be converted into currency. All right, so it's an example of what's on out there, or what's going on out there. Important part about blockchain is that the coders face huge hurdles. Blockchain right now can process about 10 transactions per second. If the credit cards processed 10 transactions per second, they'd go out of business. They do thousands of transactions per second. There are so many economies of scale that come from centralizing information. But do me a favor. Does anybody have a cell phone?
Sure.
Think about your cell phone. Pull it out. Get a visual. All right. The cell phone that you have is small, tidy. The cell phone that you first bought, think about how that compares to the one in your hand. The first cell phone would probably be a doorstop today. I mean, you couldn't watch Breaking Bad reruns on it, right? Cell phones have come so far in so few years. So what I would say is, I'm sure there's technological hurdles that coders have to solve to make blockchain a faster process. But just fast forward 20 years, project out into the future, and think about your phone as an indication of what great strides technology can make over time. And I guess the question to ask yourself about 20 years from now, it's the same question that you can ask today. Who do you want controlling your internet? Do you want a few organizations that are gathering more and more data and using it to exploit commercial opportunities? I don't mean exploit in a bad way, but using it for commercial opportunities. Or do you want that information spread around? And I think that is the significance of cryptocurrencies. I care about the blockchain. You do nothing else this evening. Remember the blockchain and this decentralization of currencies. So with that, I will take questions. And this is all. These are all the various and sundry sites I have, my author website, my work website. And we talked a little bit about identities. Well, identity theft is something I'm really riveted by. So another thing you can do is take down the website for my white paper and download the white paper, how to prevent identity theft or make yourself a smaller target. I think it's part of the bigger discussion about what's going on, segment. So let me take questions.
All right, so I have a question. I'm not quite understanding this swarm of people that you mentioned. Are these like kids in their bedroom at their parents' house after midnight that are somehow playing some role to make the transaction happen? I'm not really understanding. Who are these people? Where are they? What exactly are they doing, and how are they getting paid?
Okay, so what happened initially is they were kids in their bedrooms, and anybody who had a computer could more or less solve the problems and get paid Bitcoin. And the way they got paid is that the algorithm was coded in such a way that whoever solved the ledger transaction first received Bitcoin. Okay, and so there was this contest for it.
When you say solve the ledger transaction, all right, you're going to give somebody $100. Your account goes down by 100. Theirs has to go up. So you're saying solving means somehow connecting those two accounts and making yours go down and that go up, and that's it.
Go back to my example, Sally. My account has $10 less. Her account has $10 more. I wrote a solid check. That's it. That's all the solving.
That's it.
But the algorithm was written so that it became increasingly complicated, because the follow-up question would be, well, gee, does that mean that there's just going to be an ever-expanding universe of Bitcoin out there? Will the currency grow forever? In the case of Bitcoin, the answer is no. It's capped at 22 million coins, and that's it, period. And so going forward in the future, at some point, to entice these miners or these auditors to solve the transaction to keep the ledger current, you'll have to pay something, but it's whatever you decide. And that's starting to happen now, and I can see it when I occasionally send Bitcoin. If I don't add enough Bitcoin into a transaction, let's say I bought something at Overstock, for example. If I don't send, or if I don't include enough Bitcoin as my little fee for the money transfer, it takes forever to get it done.
Who are these people?
Yeah, but
are they centralized in like brokerage houses with Bitcoin, and you know, has it?
Okay, so most of them right now are in China, but there are a lot of folks who are also in Iceland, because the way the algorithm is written is it's tremendously inefficient. I mean, you use tons of energy running computers, and so the scenes that I've seen of the Bitcoin problem solvers have rows and rows of computers, just stacks of them, and it's this processing power that enables them to solve the equations to keep the ledger current fastest. Electricity is one issue, heat is another, and so in Iceland you'll see computer rooms buried underground. It's really cold, right? And so they don't have to worry about air conditioning. It's natural.
I believe I read somewhere that you stated that you did not put your clients into any of these currencies as investments. And if so, isn't that in contrast with, and by the way, I still don't quite understand what's happening, but that's beside the point. If you're not putting your clients into it and you're an investment professional, particularly if you went to Exeter and Harvard, right? Why in the world aren't you, if the growth seems unlimited, and this space is going to increase in power and importance in the world, why not invest in it now?
What I would say is go to Jason Weeks' article in the Wall Street Journal, where he dealt just with this. And he said, he quoted a money manager. He said, whatever you do, put in enough that you don't care about losing it. Okay. And you know, to me, the story is really not about the direction of the currency. and the price. The story is really about blockchain, because that's where the money is really going to be. It's that the use of blockchain, that database, to decentralize control of database, and the applications will be built on top of that database. That's the real importance of cryptocurrencies. You know, they can go up, they can go down. I'm not making a call on them. I don't do it for clients now, and I didn't do it in the past.
You do it for yourself.
I'm not afraid of losing anything I have.
Okay. I still don't quite get the connection between blockchain and who's controlling the internet.
Okay, so so blockchain is decentralized, and there are all of the auditors who are online 24/7. Their computers are always running, and they're trying to solve these equations that keep the ledger current. Good so far? Okay, so that there is no, it doesn't require them to know anything about who you are, who I am. That's changing, but originally it was started in such a way that you didn't have to provide your social security number or any of those things. Okay, so think about the companies that come in and they build their applications on top of the internet. The internet does a really good job of trading information back and forth, right? There are protocols for transferring data. But the companies that build their websites that facilitate that transfer of information, what they find is theirs. There is nothing in the internet right now that that enables identifying information to be open to the world as a whole. It all is controlled by the companies who build their applications. They own it, and you have to pay them to use it. Does that make sense?
What do you buy Bitcoin?
You can go online. I mean, one place is Coinbase, for example. You can try it there. In the white shirt.
Well, it seems to me that all of this goes back to the word trust.
Absolutely.
And there are two kinds of people that are playing this in my experience. I'm not one of them. There are those who trust nothing, and those who ultimately trust the base currencies that we all use because they're treating it as an investment and are a way of playing with money, but they know, they trust that they can convert it back to US dollars or euro or whatever and get their money back. So two very different camps using this thing, but trust is the key thing in both of them, I think.
Well,
the lack of it or belief in it.
I agree. You know, one of the questions that I ask all the time, how do you know you can trust somebody with your money, right? But again, the story here is that the issue of trust has moved beyond currencies. It's moving into the other applications for blockchain. Because blockchain is a database, it's moved beyond the ledger, it can be a database to save information. And if you can use the information to, as I mentioned before, record contracts, legal contracts, property title, it has powerful applications that go beyond. And we'll start to see them come out more frequently. And the issue is just really when the coders can solve their hurdles about processing information more quickly. And they are. They're making strides. Yes, ma'am.
So to be simplistic about it, you're going to take a vacation to Helsinki, correct? And Finnair is going to take, who's going to take your Bitcoin? How is Finnair going to be paid? How is, you know, you can't go to Noma anymore, but one of the good restaurants has come off of it. How does that translate to a vacation being paid off by Bitcoin investments?
So So what happened was, as I said, we had a lucky event, and it came from me just trying to understand how to make it work, right? How to open a Bitcoin vault, what to do with it. And the net of it is okay, so I had this wallet, and gee, I could see what places were saying it was worth. How do I spend it? There are some entities, there are some companies that take Bitcoin directly. If you use it with Overstock.com, simple. Expedia says that they use it. No, I'm telling you, it's not ready for prime time on Expedia's site. I don't think it works there. I used it on another travel agency site, and it worked. I mean, the travel agency, cheapair.com, it was great.
Cheapair, did you say cheapair.com?
Yeah, and so what I would say, though, is just, you know, you Google it and say, who takes Bitcoin? And up will come a list of the vendors, and some are easier than others. And I'll tell you, it is not ready for prime time. It's hard to use sometimes. It took me forever when I was trying to make it to work on Expedia to find out it didn't work particularly well there. So, you know, it's not as easy to use as a credit card. I would just say that the real importance, though, again, is that we're in the first inning of this database being controlled by lots and lots of different players, users of products, as opposed to one central authority.
One other question is, I read some of that article, and it sounds like it's IBM all over again, with these monstrous rooms of huge amounts of computers generating all this and figuring out these logarithms and so on. So it's sort of retro almost, sounding like, if this becomes the thing, where is all this technology going to be, or it will be reduced to the size of a cell phone at some point, or a small cell phone?
You got me.
I'm struggling with what appears to be a contradiction, that with digital currencies and even blockchain technology, we want anonymity. So we can do stuff which our governments don't know, which our friends don't know, which nobody else knows about us. But the distributed ledger is, what I'm saying, is keeping track of every transaction between two individuals and keeps track of that forever across multiple computers everywhere in the world. So isn't there some way that someone can find out that I bought drugs on Silk Road or something with my Bitcoin 2 years ago and be able to trace it back to my Bitcoin?
Yeah. It's just a matter of control. It's not a matter of privacy. It's a matter of control. Who benefits from the information? If the information is all on the internet itself, nobody controls it because it's in the public domain. And I would say is that data is supremely valuable. If you look at our AI right now, AI is a big topic, right? Everybody's talking about artificial intelligence. One of the things I read frequently is that China's taking a lead in AI because of its access to data. And so the folks who believe in blockchain say, put the data on the internet in a public setting where everybody has access to it. And that's going to change in the future how we think about the institutions that we take for granted, like banks, for example. If you don't, we'll have to rely on a trusted third party. Can you rely on this swarm of users out there? That's where we're, yes?
Is there only one huge ledger, or is there one ledger, the blockchain, for, let's say, Bitcoin and those other ones that you listed?
First of all, I'll be the first of, I'm not a techie. Right? there are different applications for blockchain, and there are different versions of the online ledger that blockchain is. I think, for example, the third largest currency is XRP, I mentioned at the start, and it uses a different system. but the idea is still the same, this distributed ledger that's online. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, there's more than one.
Yes.
How was it determined that the Bitcoin would be capped to whatever number you mentioned? And how is the value affected? It sounds like it varies day by day. Is it supply and demand? I mean, it's not comparable to gold where there's a physical asset.
So I'll tell you, the best quote I ever heard about, or the best commentary I ever heard about gold came from Warren Buffett. And this comes back to Bitcoin, but what Warren Buffett said about gold, is he said if people from Mars were looking at us, they'd think it's the damnedest thing that we do here. Because we spend all day digging up gold, and then we spend all of our time burying it again. He was referring to Fort Knox. Even though there's not a physical entity that you hold in its pure form, the thing about Bitcoin is it also has that transfer mechanism built into it that can live on the web. And that's what I think has the value.
But is it supply and demand that causes the value to fluctuate? Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. I have a follow-up question. What is the fail-safe? So if the computers are hacked or they're blown up, where does all the information, where do the ledgers go? Who has an ultimate ledger?
Nobody. The ledgers live on computers all over the world. So does that insulate them from being hacked and things? No, but it concentrates the problem.
Can I just add to that? Because I am a techie. The blockchain is massively redundant. So those computers on the Bitcoin network, there's 10,000 computers all having the same information. So a massive number of them could be disrupted, and it would continue to operate.
Oh, yeah, I didn't mean computer.
Disruption.
I meant the software, the system. Yeah. There isn't any way then to wipe them all out.
No.
You'd have to, you know, destroy the world with the 10,000 computers that are operating the Bitcoin.
When you hear about the spectacular failures and the hacks and things like that, it's usually an organization or a user that has created this infrastructure. And the infrastructure that does things with the Bitcoin algorithm is what ultimately is attacked.
Thank you.
Like, how do people pay sales tax to the government? Right? Like, what's happening here is
IRS,
you know,
capital gains control.
I know on capital gains tax, like, I file. This is what came out. I know exactly what came out. I have a record of it. I know what went in. And I declare it. Sales tax, I don't know.
So, thank you all for coming this evening. This is a great one.